Exodus 11:45. For I am the Lord who brought you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. You shall therefore be holy, for I am holy.
That's one of all the verses.
I know.
That's the tea verse.
Watch this
light. That's the Swiss tea verse.
King of kings and Lord of yours.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. My name is Tyler Kinney. I'm on staff here, and I want to welcome you, especially if you are a first-time visitor or one of your first few times visiting with us. We're very glad that you're here with us. Today is Palm Sunday. Next week, we anticipate celebrating the Lord's resurrection on Easter Sunday. But of course, we remember his resurrection every Sunday. And he is risen. If you would, please turn with me to page 18 of your bulletin for a few brief announcements. If you are a visitor with us and you haven't yet filled out a visitor's card, we invite you to do that. There's one in front of you in the pew, and that would be a way just to introduce yourself to us and give us any contact information that you would be willing to do so that we might follow up with you to express our appreciation for you being here and answer any questions you might have. You may also be able to leave prayer requests there so we could pray for you as well if there's anything we can lift up on your behalf. I want to call your attention to the scripture memory verse that we're beginning this week. In our progression through memorizing verses from every book of the Bible, we're now in the fourth month of the year, and in the fourth book of the Bible, the book of Numbers. And this particular passage from chapter 6 is what is known as the Aaronic blessing, named after Aaron, Moses' brother, who was the first high priest of Israel. And God commanded Aaron to put his name upon the people and therefore to bless them. And he said that you should say this, Aaron, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. These verses are a great reminder to us of where blessing is found. It's found in the name of the Lord and particularly in his face upon us. That word for face is the same word for countenance in the following verse. And so we see that our greatest blessing comes in knowing God and in having his face upon us. And this is a great way for us to pray for one another and to memorize and to cherish these words, store them up in our hearts. We might be ready to seek the Lord's blessing for ourselves, but also to pray it for others. If you would turn to the next page with me, please. I want to call your attention to, in 2 weeks from today, is a congregational meeting after the service. Darren will say more about that later, but just mark your calendars for a congregational meeting in 2 weeks. Also in 2 weeks, further down the page, regarding Sunday morning adult Sunday school, we've just finished a couple Sunday school classes this morning, and we'll start a new one 2 weeks from today, after Easter, on the duties of Christian fellowship. And this is a shorter-term study. We'll be looking at what does it mean for us to be a church together? What are our duties to one another and how we love and care for each other? And we'll be following a book by John Owen on that topic, but looking at Scripture primarily as we study that topic. On the following page, page 20, just want to call your attention as well. We have a couple of new men's Bible studies starting up on Tuesday and Thursday morning. We've just concluded a study on the book of James, and we'll be getting one on the Christian doctrine of vocation on Tuesday mornings and one on the book of Jonah on Thursday mornings there. So some new opportunities for the men in the congregation to jump into a new study with other men. But of course, any time is a good time to jump in, and that goes for the women as well for their study. On the last page, page 21, call your attention to, once again, another meeting on the 16th. After the congregational meeting, there's an opportunity to receive more information about the multi-generational summer mission project to Dalton, Georgia, this summer. So if that's of interest to you, I encourage you to read more about that and to participate in that meeting, potentially. And then next Sunday, we do have our Easter brunch during the Sunday school hour. So at 9:15 a.m., come for time of fellowship. Invite your neighbors, your friends, to come and enjoy that food and that fellowship together before our worship service at 10:30 in the morning. And that's next Sunday, but between now and then next Friday, or this coming Friday, that is Good Friday, and we will have a service at 7 p.m. This Good Friday as well. I believe that's all for the announcements. If you would please turn with me back to page 1 for our call to worship. Before we stand for the call to worship, I want to pray for us. And before I pray for us, I just want to pray in particular for a church in our denomination. Many of you may be aware of what happened in Nashville this week, the great tragedy that occurred, and that strikes closer to home. They're all of these tragedies are tragic and are worthy of our prayers. This one is of a sister church in our denomination, and there are, we know people there. People here have relationships with people there who are even on site at the time. And so we just want to lift them up, especially this morning, and pray for them as they gather for worship this morning, too, and ask for the Lord to bless them. So please join me in prayer as we begin. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that in all our suffering, that we are not alone, but that you know suffering in your Son, Jesus. And you don't stand far off, but you are near to us. Ever-present help in time of trouble and in time of grief and sorrow and loss. And we praise you for that. And we thank you also, Lord, that as we consider death, We thank you, Lord, that you have removed its sting by taking it upon yourself in your Son Jesus upon the cross. And that though we do grieve, and rightly so, we grieve the loss of life, we thank you that we know of life to come and of a resurrection of the dead and the justification of all those who know you through your Son Jesus. So we thank you for the great hope we have. We pray now for our brothers and sisters at Covenant Presbyterian in Nashville. We pray, Lord, that in the midst of their loss, that you would bless and keep them. We pray, Lord, that in the midst of their darkness, that you would grant your face to shine upon them and that you would be gracious to them. We pray that in their grief, Father, that you would lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace. And Father, as we now prepare to worship you together as your people this morning, we ask that you would bless all of our acts of worship this morning, our praying, our singing, our listening to your word, the preaching of your word, that your name might be honored, that we might be edified. Lord, our partaking of the sacrament this morning, of the Lord's Supper, grant us, we pray, to be present, heart, soul, mind, and strength this morning, to worship you sincerely by the power of your Holy Spirit. And in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Please stand for our call to worship. I will read the light print, ask you to respond in the bold from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me free. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. Bind the festal sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you.
seated. We come now to our affirmation of faith and corporate prayer confession, and I want to lump them together briefly, because as I thought about today's affirmation of faith being the Apostles' Creed, it always strikes me when we look at it, there's a lot of words about Christ compared to the Father and the Spirit. And historically, I've always thought, and I think it is primary, that's because there's a lot of heresy around Jesus. And our goal in what we recite here is to remember who Jesus is, to be very clear on who he is. But I also want to call your attention to the first words in our corporate prayer confession. Lord Jesus, we stand in wonder at your majesty. And part of it is that what Jesus did for us is just scandalous. It's amazing. It's hard to believe that he, the Lord of glory, left his throne and suffered and died for us. So as we read today both of these, would we remember just how majestic and wondrous what he did for us? So if you'll read with me the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. After our corporate prayer confession, we'll have a time of silent confession before our assurance of pardon. So please join me. Lord Jesus, we stand in wonder at your majesty. We confess that we often fail to grasp your divinity and glory. Lord Jesus, thank you for descending into hell. Through your death on the cross and burial in the tomb, you experienced for us every aspect of death. In the grave, you bore the curse of death, separation from your heavenly Father, and toiled under the power of death for a season to fully satisfy God's righteous wrath against sin and secure our pardon from it. Gracious Heavenly Father, forgive us for not pondering the depth of your sacrificial love for us. King Jesus, remind us of the sufficiency, once for all, of your sacrificial death for our sins. Pardon us for not recognizing your descent into hell for us. Glorious Holy Spirit, thank you for enabling our confession. In Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you that you devised such a wondrous plan of salvation for your people. Lord Jesus, we just praise you. Lord, I confess that I often forget the magnitude of the work and never really understood the fullness of it. Lord, please forgive me for belittling your sacrifice. We praise you that you would do such a thing for ones such as us. And not only that you would do these things, but that you would remind us constantly of the sufficiency of your work for us. So Lord, please forgive us, know our frame. Help us, Holy Spirit, to see more clearly the work that you have done for us through Christ. And we pray this all in his name. Amen. Our assurance of pardon comes from Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he, Christ Jesus, has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please stand as we now sing, Arise, My Soul, Arise.
Father, we thank you for the great confidence that we have as we draw near to you, because we have a surety before your throne in your Son, our Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for this. And Lord, we thank you for every blessing beside. Countless blessings, too numerous for us to recount here now. But we thank you, Lord, for providing all of our needs. And we pray, Lord, that of what we bring back to you here in worship and our tithes and our offerings, you would be pleased to use that to help others know about the surety that stands before the throne, that can be their surety too, through faith alone. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
please stand for the doxology.
Seated. Prior to the reading of our sermon text, just a few updates. First, I do, sometimes I look at things and I go, how in the world did that happen? I was just looking at our announcements, and somehow or another, our announcements about Easter week didn't make it into our bulletin. And that's really on me. So I was just sitting here going, how in the world did that not happen? But at the end of the day, it did. I want to encourage us, right? There are some invitations in the hallway reminding us to invite our neighbors to come and join us for our Easter festivities. Good Friday service at 7 p.m. That is a 10-embrace service, which is unique in the sense that we will really walk through the Passion story. We will end at the crucifixion, although we know there is a resurrection. We'll come back on Sunday to celebrate that. It's an evening that's sober is one of the ways to describe it, and that will help prepare us, if you will, for Easter Sunday. Our Easter Sunday does start with brunch, so a great opportunity for you to come and enjoy fellowship with one another. There is a sign-up sheet in the hallway to help with brunch, both by way of food, but also by way of helping with setup and cleanup. And I know that Carol would appreciate assistance there. And so just want to remind us of those things. Secondly, you saw, and there was a little bit of awkwardness in Tyler, the announcement of a congregational meeting. And so what I want to highlight there are a couple things. First and foremost, joy. Okay? The purpose of the congregational meeting on the 16th is the session will bring before you, members of the congregation, a recommendation that you elect Tyler Kinney to serve as associate pastor of Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. That will be what comes before you. That will be the only thing on our agenda. And so we will bring that recommendation to you unanimously. We will ask you to consider both Tyler's work among us as a pastoral intern and as a director, and how we've seen God's grace and ministry in him and through him to us, and his good labor among us, that we think it has been very clear the Lord's calling Tyler to pastoral ministry and to serve this congregation. There's a lot of steps in this equation as we outlined for you in a congregational letter in November, December of last year. And so we're taking steps, and in some ways they're steps of faith, because you need to pray, because this Tuesday, that's the 4th of April, Tyler will be examined by the committee from our presbytery moving towards accepting his ordination. And so that's an oral exam. It will take half day, and so you can pray for his stamina, his recall, and we're trusting that as he's done well on his written exams, so he will do well on his oral exams. The 16th, we will stand for election here with our congregation, and then on the 18th, he'll stand to be examined again by the presbytery as a whole and be on the floor of presbytery, which just simply means he gets to stand before a larger body and they get to ask him questions. Lord willing, all that will result in this. On May 7th, by God's grace, Tyler Kinney will be installed and ordained as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ and a pastor of this church. So I'm giving you the update and calling you to pray and prepare for our role in that on the 16th as a congregation. Next, I just want to give you an idea of where we're headed next sermon series-wise before we come back here and read our sermon text in Esther. We conclude today our study of the book of Esther. Next week, we will come, as it is Easter, the opportunity to look at 1 Corinthians 15 and the purpose of the resurrection, its significance, we'll consider. And so I want us to have one thought: without the resurrection, you have no hope. And we'll come and look at 1 Corinthians 15 next week. Then we'll be moving for a series, and you need to hear that part, in the book of Revelation. Some of you have seen the book of Revelation and going, oh, we're going through the whole book of Revelation for the next 3 years. We are only going to be looking at the first three chapters of the book of Revelation. Because what we want to be looking at, although we'll be moving through it verse by verse and expositionally, particularly we're going to be looking at the seven churches in Revelation and what we can learn from them. You'll find that they're commended and they are rebuked. They have strengths and they have weaknesses. And we, as the Church of Jesus Christ, probably have some areas where we might need to be rebuked, and some areas where we are commendable and we have some strengths and weaknesses. So our desire is to what? To learn from the Word of God of how we can be the church that Christ wants us to be. And so that's where we're headed next. So not even an introduction, a prelude, so you will, to the reading of our sermon text. Let's turn there now. Our sermon text this morning, Esther chapter 9, verse 20 through Esther chapter 10, verse 3, this is the inspired, holy, and inerrant Word of God that is profitable to His people. Let's read this. Let me read this for us. And Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, obliging them to keep the 14th day of the month of Adar and also the 15th day of the same year, year by year, as the days on which the Jews got relief from their enemies, and the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and for mourning into holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days of sending gifts of food to one another and gifts to the poor. So the Jews accepted what they had started to do, what Mordecai had written to them for Haman the Agite, the son of Hammedatha, the enemy of the Jews, had plotted against the Jews to destroy them, and had cast pur, that is, casting lots, to crush and to destroy them. But when it came before the king, he gave orders in writing that the evil plan that had been devised against the Jews should be returned on their head, and that he and his sons should be hanged in the gallows. Therefore, they called these days Purim, after the term poor. Therefore, because of all that was written in the letter, and of what had been and what they had faced in this matter, and what had happened to them, the Jews firmly obligated themselves and their offspring, and all who joined them, that without fail they would keep these 2 days according to what was written at the time appointed every year. That these days should be remembered and kept throughout every generation, in every clan, province, and city, and that these days of Purim should never fall into disuse among the Jews, nor should the commemoration of these days cease among their descendants. Then Queen Esther, the daughter of Abihail, and Mordecai, the Jew, gave full written authority, confirming this second letter of Purim. Letters were sent to all the Jews in the 127 provinces of King Ahasuerus, in words of peace and truth, that these days of Purim should be observed at all appointed seasons, as Mordecai the Jew and Queen Esther obligated them, and as they had obligated themselves and their offspring with regard to their fast and their laments. The command of Esther confirmed these practices of Purim, and it was recorded in writing. King Ahasuerus imposed taxes on the land and on the coastlands of the sea, and all the acts of his power and might, and the full account of the high honor of Mordecai, to which the king advanced him, are they not written in the books of the chronicles of the kings of Media and Persian? For Mordecai the Jew was second in rank to King Ahasuerus, and he was great among the Jews and popular with the multitude of his brothers, for he sought the welfare of his people and spoke peace to all his people. Give me understanding. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your astounding grace to us. We thank you this morning for your word and ask now that you would help us as your people to understand and apply your word. Father, would you strengthen our faith? Would you make us more like our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? And Father, for those who do not know him this morning, Father, would the day be the day of salvation and deliverance from evil? For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. The book of Esther, as we've seen, is filled with many ups and downs. And in some ways, perhaps it raises more questions than it answers. For example, who is the main character of the story? Esther or Mordecai? Surely it's Esther, right? In verse 29 of her passage, it's Queen Esther's authority that confirms the second letter sent throughout the Persian Empire on the establishment of the Jewish festival of Purim. Without Esther's rise to power, her seduction of King Ahasuerus, her courage to come invited before the king, her plan and boldness to reveal her Jewish identity and how Haman's plan would bring the destruction of both herself and her people, and her influence to bring her cousin Mordecai into the power as prime minister of Persia, right? The deliverance of the Jewish people from Persian genocide would not have happened. Yet, in chapter 10, it's the acts of Mordecai that are commended to us. Surely Mordecai is the main character, right? Without his counsel, Esther may not have risen to power in Persia. Without his uncovering the plot to assassinate King Ahasuerus, Mordecai's loyalty and fidelity would have never been known to the king. Without Mordecai's political savvy and influence among the Jews, unwillingness to bow down to Haman, the king's signet ring on his hand as prime minister, God's promises to bring judgment and justice upon the Amalekites would not have been fulfilled. So, who is the main character of the book of Esther, and what is it about? Why did God, in His divine and infinite wisdom, inspire the narrator of Esther to record for us this book of infallible truth? As we saw last week, the book of Esther is about a great reversal. When the evil plot of Haman to destroy the Jews is codified into Persian law, right? The fate of the Jewish people seems what? Absolutely set and doomed. Yet, as we've seen in a complete reversal of events and fate, Haman is executed. The enemies of the Jews throughout the entire Persian Empire are killed for their attack against the Jews, and the sons of Haman are hung on the gallows that their father built to execute Mordecai. The destruction of the Jewish people is thwarted, and they are delivered and they are blessed as Mordecai and Esther rule and advance in the kingdom of Persia. This great reversal saves not only God's people in exile, but God's promise of redemption is secured. God's promise of redemption that will reverse the curse of sin, its reign and its rule over humanity, is secured by the deliverance of His people from whom He promised the Redeemer would come. As our passage shows us, the book of Esther is to serve as a reminder. We are to remember. The Feast of Purim is to help us and God's people remember and tell the next generation. Like our stories, like our history, the book of Esther is remembered from one or two perspectives. The book of Esther can be remembered as a story of chance, human intuition, destiny, or cosmic fate. Ultimately, in this view, God is not present. God is not personal. He is not involved by providing for anyone or His people. Perhaps He's just provided structure. This is simply a man-centered view. In this man-centered view, we are to remember the great reversal in the story of Esther as the result of fate, opportunity, human ingenuity, and sometimes just a little luck. In this view, the acts of Mordecai and Esther are seen as self-made and taking advantage of opportunity and coincidence. In this man-centered view, the role of God and faith are marginalized. At most, God and faith are simply an expression of a worldview. God is an add-on or an accessory. The second perspective is God-centered. Woven into the Feast of Purim, as we will see, the narrator of Esther wants us to see God at work. Although God is not mentioned and the faith of God's people in exile has been diluted and compromised, God remains faithful. In His sovereignty, He is orchestrating all history to accomplish His good purpose, even graciously through the nominal faith of Esther and Mordecai. As we will either see the story of Esther through the lens of faith, which is God-centered, or the lens of fatalism, which is man-centered. This is true of our lives and the story of our lives as well, is it not? How do you view the events of your day? How do you view the events of your week? Do you find your story in God's story, or is your story simply a series of cause and effect, choices, and fate? Esther is calling us to remember God, His saving grace, His power to deliver us from sin, its curse in Christ Jesus, His preserving grace to counter His and all of our enemies. Do you believe that God is sovereign? Do we believe that God is in control of every part of His good creation? Do we believe that in God's providence He is working all things and all His creatures to accomplish all His good purposes? The main character of the book of Esther is God. He wants us to see His glorious reign, His glorious rule, and His power in every single detail of our life. Thus, the book of Esther calls us to remember God, to remember how He saved, how He delivered, how He blessed the Jews even while they were in exile because of their sin. He did so for His own glory and the good of His people, and to maintain and to fulfill His redemptive purposes and promises. Our passage today calls us to remember God. It outlines for us in our passage the when, the what, the how, and the who of remembering. If you're taking notes, our big heading this morning is remember, and under that comes the when, what, how, and who. And our last main heading this morning is just simply reflection. The when under remember. Remembering is hard work. Our sinful human tendency is to forget. We're consumed, if we're honest, with the day today. We work, we play, and our present circumstances press in, and we forget. In verses 20 through 22, Mordecai not only records the events that just happened in chapter 9, creating a permanent record of the salvation of the Jewish people, but he sends letters to all the Jews throughout the entire empire to obligate them to do what? To remember. The days, the 14th and the 15th of Adar, are to be days year by year to remember the days that the Jews got relief from their enemies. The day they were given rest, peace from their enemies. The 14th representing the peace in the provinces of Persia, and the 15th representing the day of peace in the capital of Susa. In verses 23 through 28, we're told that the Jews in exile accept this obligation to remember, maintaining the days of Purim without fail, and to tell these events faithfully from generation to generation. Note the importance and intentionality of remembering that is highlighted in our passage. The Feast of Purim was established and was to be perpetually observed, as the Jews were obligated by Mordecai, by Esther, and their own acceptance for themselves and their offspring to remember. year after year, the salvation and the deliverance of the Jews during their exile in the Persian Empire was to be remembered. The Feast of Purim was the last festival of the year on the Jewish calendar. The Jewish calendar ends with the Feast of Purim, and it begins with the celebration of Passover, both feasts of deliverance and salvation. But what is the what under remember? What is it that we are to remember? In verses 20 through 22, we learn in summary what we're to remember. On the 14th and 15th of Adar, we are to remember the day the Jews got rest from their enemies, and sorrow was turned to gladness. The days when mourning was transformed into a holiday of celebration. We're to remember that great reversal. We're to remember the days that the Jews were delivered from the curse of death. The edict of Haman that brought great sorrow and distress to God's people was turned around by the counter edict of Mordecai that resulted in life and gladness. Generation to generation, to remember how the fasting and lament of God's people in chapter 4 was turned to gladness and feasting. How are we to remember? We are to remember yearly on the 14th and the 15th of the month of Adar the rest, the peace, salvation, and deliverance from death of God's people from their enemies while in exile. This annual celebration is to be with feasting, gladness, and gifts of food to one another. Food is needed to sustain life. Bread, water, grain, meat are all products from the earth that help preserve and give life. Food is a gift from God. Implicitly, the giving and receiving of food represents God's blessing and favor. It is only God who sustains us. Famine in the Bible often represents God's judgment as it results in the lack of food and water. So the feasting represents God's care, God's provision, God's bounty, and God's blessing. The who. Who are we to remember? We're to remember God and His sovereignty. Just as the Feast of Purim represents God's provision through the giving and receiving of food implicitly, so the name of the feast, Purim, is to remind us that God is sovereign. He is sovereign and present and in control of every details of our life and every moment of history. In a sort of odd way to us, the Feast of Purim refers to Haman's actions in chapter 3. The casting of a pur, the casting of lots, to determine the day and the month of the planned destruction of the Jews. In the ancient Near East, casting lots was a way to determine the will of a man-made God or our fate. In biblical theology, if God is sovereign over everything, then He is sovereign over the casting of lots. God turns the die, if you will, the lot, as He wills. Listen to Proverbs 16:33. The lot is cast in the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. You see, the Feast of Purim is to remind God's people that God is sovereign over the plans of man. Haman may have cast his lot in his lap. In the kingdom of man, it may appear that destiny, that the lot of the Jews was fixed and determined by the hand of Haman. But in reality, every decision is from the Lord. The Feast of Purim clearly and yet subtly reveals God's sovereignty at work in His provision of life, the giving of food, and as He is Lord over every decision of the kings, kingdoms, and of all mankind. Salvation belongs to the Lord. So the deliverance of the Jews from the edict of Haman, the primary actor in Esther's story, is the Lord as He is orchestrating every decision. In his divine power and wisdom, God directs even the sinful plots of mankind to fulfill and accomplish his purposes, and yet he is not the author of sin or corrupted by it. As in Joseph's story, God's sovereignty directs in such a way that what man intends for evil, the Lord will use for good. The Feast of Purim calls us to remember that God is present in exile, present when evil is reigning and ruling, present in His glorious deliverance. The book of Esther calls us to see God's sovereign reign and rule in every venue and every detail of our lives. Three reflections this morning. As I proposed in our introduction, the book of Esther calls us to remember God, how He saved, how He delivered, how He blessed the Jews while in exile. He did so for His glory and the good of His people and to maintain His redemptive purposes and promises. First reflection, salvation belongs to the Lord. Like the Passover, the Feast of Purim calls us to remember God's historical acts of deliverance. The acts of salvation foreshadow God's ultimate act of salvation through the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ. God uses Esther and Mordecai, despite their sin, despite their failure, their nominal faith to save His people in exile from Haman's curse of death. God uses Esther and Mordecai to be agents of peace to His people as they sacrificially pursue the well-being of God's people above their own. Although the curse of Haman was thwarted, the curse of sin and death remains. At the end of the book of Esther, there is a greater work of salvation that is needed and yet to come. God's promise of salvation and redemption from sin have preserved God's deliverance in Persia, but it will be fulfilled by Jesus Christ. Jesus, the divine Son of God, becomes flesh from the line and lineage of David, to be the obedient Son of God that we and our sinful flesh will and can never be. Jesus seeks our welfare by giving Himself sacrificially in death and in life on a cross to pay the guilt and penalty of our sin. The salvation and the deliverance that the feast and the festivals of the Old Testament foreshadow find their fullest fulfillment in Christ Jesus. By faith in the works of Jesus, His death for our sin, and His perfect record for our imperfect record, we have peace with God. In Christ, we are restored for all eternity into a relationship with God. God through Christ has paid the price for our adoption as sons and daughters of God. So as we celebrate the Lord's table this morning and Easter Sunday next week, we rest by faith on the power of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ to rescue us from the curse of sin and death. Remember that salvation belongs to the Lord. Second reflection, Nashville. This week we lament the evil acts of another school shooting. Every school shooting, the unprovoked taking of human life, is tragic and a cruel reminder that we live in a world that is broken and tarnished by sin. School shootings or mass shootings remind us that we are not safe. Our lives are more fragile than we want to admit. That the taking of human life and those who perpetrate such evil not only reside in war zones, but exist in our zip code. In truth, murderous thoughts reside in each of our hearts. Perhaps, like me, the events of this past week have felt more personal, closer to home as they've occurred to a sister Presbyterian church. In fact, this past fall, Claudia, Amy, and I were at a conference hosted by Covenant Presbyterian Church in Nashville. As I'm prone to wander in buildings, I have walked the halls of this church and day school with tears. In prayer, we bring our lament and sorrow to the Lord. We join our Christian brothers and sisters in Nashville this week in tears. And we ask that God would comfort from the ashes of pain and suffering that we can only imagine. unlike the story of Esther, sometimes the Hamans of this world win the temporal battle, but not the eternal battle. The way of the gospel, the way of salvation, is from suffering to glory, as we'll be reminded as we consider the Passion this coming week. Jesus suffering and died in a world to satisfy God's wrath against sin for all eternity, and to demonstrate God's love by redeeming us through His substitutionary life and death for simple man. In Christ Jesus, as His people, we reside as pilgrims in this world. We are exiles, and as exiles, although we're citizens of heaven and no longer slaves to sin and free from its guilt and penalty, we still are wounded inside and out as we live in the presence of sin in this world. One day upon the return of King Jesus, that judgment day, that day when Jesus will gather the redeemed of the Lord to enter into the rest and fellowship of the Lord God, a day when sin will be no more, a day when tears, disease, pain, suffering, injustice, and mourning will cease for God's people for all eternity. A day when eternal feasting and celebration and praise of our God, great God, will continue for all eternity. This is a day when all will be made new and all will be whole, my friends. Although already the Christian witness of Nashville victims, the outpouring of prayer and kindness and the weeping of the Christian community, the Godward response of parents, and the many God-centered and biblical letters and responses and articles may represent some of the ways how God will turn this sorrow into gladness even now. But it will not be until the redeemed children of God are gathered by and in Christ Jesus to our heavenly home that this tragedy and all its pain and suffering caused by sin and all its effects will be turned from death to life, mourning to gladness with great celebration. Yes, by God's grace, some of the ashes and mourning will be turned to gladness. This is the power of God's transforming grace in us. But eternal comfort and hope rest in the day that is yet to come. The book of Esther calls us to remember a temporal rest and deliverance of God's people from their enemies, to remember a season of blessing and fruitfulness for God's people in exile under the rule of Mordecai and Esther. But the deliverance in Persia is not enough. The peace that God's people experience under Mordecai, who sought their welfare above his own, is not enough. The book of Esther not only announces to us God's future plan of salvation in Christ Jesus, but the day of consummation when all God's redemptive plans and purposes will be fulfilled, and we will feast, my friends, as we will see in a moment at the wedding supper of the Lamb. Third, reflection. Two perspectives. We can look at the book of Esther. We can read the book of Esther. We can look at the story of our lives and the events of our lives and the chapters of our lives from two perspectives. The first is man-centered. This is fate. This is a fatalistic perspective. Man-centered perspective is just cause and effect. Coincidence. Fate. Destiny. A little yin, a little yang. But I want to encourage us and admonish us that a man-centered perspective is fatal. There is no salvation in a man-centered perspective. Thus, it is a fatal perspective. It is not only fatal for salvation, but as we fall prey to it, even if we're in Christ, it is fatal to our sanctification. Because see, if we go through life just simply thinking that God is not really sovereign, it's just a matter of what I do and don't do, then we fall what? Back into the untruths and the lie of that which is not the gospel of grace. So we'll either live by a man-centered perspective or a God-centered perspective. God-centered means that God is sovereign. More than sovereign, we think of that word and it's so high and lofty, and it is, but He is personal. He is governing over every detail of my life for His glory and my good. Does that not change the way we think and live, my friends? He is a God who is rescuing, redeeming, and restoring His people. Where a man-centered perspective is a fatal perspective, a God-centered perspective is life-giving, eternal life-giving. So as we conclude our study in the book of Esther, I leave us with this simple thought. Will you remember God, or will you remember man? Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your word. We ask that You would take this word and apply it to our hearts. Father, where we need Your gift of repentance, whether it be repentance from, as Your children, from man-centered views, would You grant us that repentance? Or whether, Father, we need repentance because we have never bent the knee to a sovereign God who saves through His Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us Your gifts of repentance and faith, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we now sing, Behold the Lamb.
Please be seated. In just a moment, we'll participate in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper with one another. It's important to remember, as our theme this morning, what is happening here. There's something past, present, and future that the table reminds us of. Past, Jesus died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture. Our past, present, and future sins are covered by the blood of Christ. Christ's table reminds us of His pardon and sacrifice for our sins. Present. See, the Lord's table, at His table, this is the table of Christ. And He is present in, through, and around the elements through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. So we gain, as we participate, a present help and a reminder that Christ is with us. And His yoke is easy and His burden is light. But as we pointed to, it also reminds us of a greater table that is yet to come. There's no secret, it's just a cup of grape juice and a little piece of bread. But there will be a day of feast, and when we will celebrate with the Lord, in the presence of the Lord, for all eternity, and we will feast and sup, and that feast is wine and meat in abundance. And so we come also anticipating that which is yet to come, the hope we have in Christ Jesus of the resurrection. Who is to come? This is a table of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a table for those who are Christians, for those who have professed by repentance and faith their reliance on Christ alone as their Lord and Savior. It's for Christians who are part of an evangelical church, as thus have been interviewed as to their Christian witness. And so this is not Emmanuel's table, a Presbyterian table. This is Christ's table. And it's for those who profess faith in Christ and who are in good standing of Christ's church. If you're not a Christian, and I always say this, if you're not yet a Christian, this table is an invitation. This table is not an invitation to come and partake yet. It's an invitation to come first to the Lord Jesus who is Lord over this table. And so we don't want you to pretend to be someone or something that you're not. First, come to Christ before coming to His table. Last, this is for the weak. This table is for the weak. It's not for those who got it all right this week. It's for those who recognize that Jesus got it all right for them. But you know, if you are in sin and unwilling to repent and move away from that and rest on the work of Christ, please let the elements pass by. Ask for the grace of repentance. And the act of letting the elements pass by is that act of asking God to give you the heart of repentance the table points us to. There'll be some who are joining us later today as they listen to our worship service. We just ask and encourage you to use this time as we partake of the Lord's table as a season of reflection, a season of longing, and a season of prayer. You'll notice in your bulletin on page 13, a responsive reading there. Let us together proclaim the hope of the church. I received the Lord what I also delivered to you, the Lord Jesus Christ. The night He was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it, right? And He said, "This is My body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." We remember. And at the same time, He did what? He took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant of My blood. Do this, and as you drink of it, in remembrance of Me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." Let me pray. Father, we thank You for these common elements. We pray now that You would take these common elements and these signs and remind us of the beautiful and deep truths they represent. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Brothers, as our brothers come forward, you may receive the elements this morning by coming forward to the rails, covenant families that come forward, children that have not yet been admitted to the table will be prayed for. Or you can remain in your seat if you're more comfortable, and Mike will bring the elements to you. If you remain in your seat, please raise your hand. That will indicate his need to come in your direction. Thank you. Father, we thank you for feeding us. We thank you for reminding us that in Christ Jesus we have life. And in Christ Jesus, he has taken away our sin. And in Christ Jesus, he will come again. Now, as your people, would you help us sing and rejoice over these truths? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us sing now together. Stand and sing, Forever Jesus.
Grateful for your presence here this morning. If you're visiting, we're honored by your visit. If you have questions this morning, you'd like to know more about the gospel of Jesus Christ, love to have that conversation with you. I'll be in the breezeway to start that conversation or schedule that conversation. But you know, the person next to you would also love to tell you about the reasons for hope that they have and how they can sing, "My King Forever, Jesus." I want to encourage us to come back this week. Come back on Friday evening for our Good Friday service and join us for brunch and for our Easter service on Sunday as we celebrate the resurrection. do want to say thank you this morning. You were blessed, for those of you that were here just a little earlier, perhaps on time, by a prelude of our kids singing this morning. And so thank you to Barb and Bree, Scott, Allison, and I could go down the list of many people who invest time and energy in teaching our young kids. Thank you for that ministry and blessing us this morning through those voices. Receive the benediction this morning, your memory verse. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace.